May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Some words from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 6, parts of the 10th and 11th verses. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers, the enemies, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Be strong in the Lord. Paul knows how to bring it. How do you serve God in a spiritually challenging world? How do you? Do you believe that spiritual warfare is real? You know, every day, whether we realize it or not, we are in a spiritual battle. Think about it. What's been your greatest struggle? Maybe it's discord or dissension in the family. And on the surface, it seems as if, well, this is an everyday argument. We just have an argument ever so often. But at the basis of that, I believe there is a spiritual battle. Because wherever the family is being torn apart, there is disunity. And that may require forgiveness. And you may struggle with forgiveness. Isn't that a spiritual battle? It may be a battle of the wills, responding to the situation God's way or your way. Whose will prevail? It is a spiritual battle. And even if it's not something as huge as discord in the family, just think about the many things that occur in church that distract you from hearing the message of God. The things that we sometimes think about, how long is he going to preach, as opposed to the content of what's being preached, right? What are the readings? And our minds wonder, when am I going to fix, or what am I going to fix for dinner? We are in a constant spiritual battle. We are in a struggle. Our hymns remind us of it. Our readings remind us of it. And Paul is right on the money. I love some of those hymns that we sang that reminded us we are in this warfare. You know, one of my favorites were, "We are soldiers of Christ who is mighty to save," right? "We are soldiers of Christ who is mighty to save. And the banner, his cross, is unfurled. We are pledged to be faithful and steadfast and brave against Satan, the flesh, and the world." And then there's soldiers who are Christ below. And then we just sang one, stand up for Jesus. We are in a spiritual battle. Are you ready for battle? See, in these whole armor of God verses, Paul warns us that we face powerful, malignant opponents, principalities and powers, the world's rulers of darkness and spiritual forces of wickedness. This present age may not be comfortable with the language of evil or spiritual warfare, but that does not negate its reality. I believe that evil is real and it is present in our world. And so if you think that Paul has overstated the notion of spiritual warfare, perhaps you have closed your eyes to the overwhelming presence of evil in our midst. The violence and ruthlessness and greed that dominate people's lives at times. The self-destructive behaviors that hamstring so many people. The great divide that separates the very rich from the very poor. Yes, there are many wonderful people in our world, don't get me wrong. And I affirm the goodness of God's world. But I also believe, as the Bible warns, the devil is like a roaring lion, prowling the earth, seeking to devour whom he may. What battles are you facing in your life? We not only face warfare in our world, but also within ourselves. Did you notice that? The hymn, "Just As I Am," talks about fightings and fears within, without. Pick up on that line. They remind us that our spiritual battles are not just outside in the world, but they're also within our hearts. That the rulers of darkness have infiltrated our spiritual bloodstream, so to speak, to aspire to sit on the throne of our hearts. While we struggle to deal with the evil that exists all around, we also contend with spiritual challenges within our thoughts and our will. Yes, the spiritual battle is on the inside as well. And so in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 following, Paul is telling us how to protect ourselves, how to establish a solid defense, how to serve God in a spiritually challenging world, how to parry, that is to ward off the rulers of darkness. He tells us how to live godly lives and serve God well in a spiritually challenging world, a world in which people no longer want to even mention the word God. They don't want to have anything to do with who God is. We are called to be part of that battle. And so how do we serve God amidst those spiritual challenges? You ask me? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because Paul tells us right here today in Ephesians. See, we must remember that when Paul wrote this letter, he was in prison. And he was probably chained to a soldier who was charged with guarding him. And so he took his images from the guard's military uniform and he used it to send a clear message. The first thing he says, put the belt of truth on. So the Roman soldiers wore loose tunics, and it would sometimes get in the way if they were in battle. And so they wore a belt to keep their tools, the sword, but also to keep their tunics in place. What is Paul telling us when he says, fasten the belt of truth around your waist? He's saying, speak the truth at all times, because the truth sets you free. And when we speak the truth, it keeps our character intact. Nobody can question us or our credibility or our character if we speak the truth. Nobody can hold anything against you. And you know what? We don't have to wrestle in our consciences late at night if we live the truth, if we speak the truth. Anybody ever told a lie? Now, I know you haven't, but when I was younger, I may have told one or two, right? But that's all, I promise you. But we wrestle with it at night when we don't speak the truth. More importantly, he's saying, let the truth of who God is abide in your heart. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And each day, we must gird ourselves with the truth of who God is. And we must speak that truth on a daily basis. Well, he also saw the breastplate that protected the soldier's heart. And he said, put on the breastplate of righteousness. What do you pour into your hearts on a daily basis? How do you protect that spirit called heart? In other words, what do you listen to every morning, every day? What's going into your heart? My elementary school teacher used to say, garbage in, garbage out, right? Pour something of substance in your heart so that we may learn to live righteously. We must ensure that we are filling our hearts with righteousness. In other words, he's urging us to live rightly because righteousness is a defense, an excellent defense against this world's enemies. People cannot, dear friends, bring us down when we live right. When we live right, we let the world know that we are children, soldiers of the one true living God. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. He says, put on the gospel shoes. He tells us that whatever will make us ready to proclaim the gospel of peace, that is what we must do on a daily basis. I don't know what your practices are. Maybe part of it is yoga. Maybe part of it is reading spiritual inspiration, prayer, reading the Bible, listening to music early in the morning. What is it that you do to help you prepare for the day and to be in touch with God? He's saying we have to put these things into practice and we have to be intentional about it on a daily basis. Shoes on our feet are a sign of readiness for our mission. Think about it. The soldier with his boots off is at a serious disadvantage when the action starts. He can't perform his mission very well. Our mission as Christians is to proclaim the gospel, and we need to be ready, ready on the spur of the moment to do that. Are you ready? And do you have your shoes on each day? Paul then moves on to the soldier's shield. The soldier's shield was made of a thick wood. You know why that was? Because back then they used flaming arrows. And so when the soldier would be hit with a flaming arrow, the thick wood will quell the fire. And so they wore these thick shields. And so Paul tells us, put on the shield of faith so that it will quench the flaming darts of the evil one. What darts are being fired at you right now in your life? Someone trying to get between your family? Maybe on the job you're facing certain challenges? Maybe at home you face some challenges? Maybe at church you face some challenges? What darts are being fired at your life? Paul is asking us to put on the shield of faith. And that means trust God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. It means regardless of what's going on in our world, we trust that God has the whole world in his hands, that this is God's world. And in the end, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. We're going to have moments of doubt, but Paul says, keep faith alive. You know what faith is? It is the greatest antidote to anxiety and depression. We only get anxious and worried when we're out of control. But if we believe that God is always in control, there is no need to be anxious about anything. Why worry about tomorrow, says Paul. And so faith, dear friends, just so you know, it's not that everything will turn out okay. It's being okay in spite of how things turn out. Because we trust that God always has a handle on the situation. Put on the shield of faith, and you can live in a spiritually challenging world. Paul then saw the soldier's helmet, and he said, take the helmet of salvation. Now, Peyton, you play sports, and you could get an ankle injury. You could get a hamstring injury. None of these will kill you. But a blow to the head can paralyze you and kill you as well. And so Paul says, put on the helmet of salvation, because that's the most important piece of equipment a soldier could have. What am I saying to you? What is Paul telling us? Guard your minds fiercely. Guard your minds fiercely so that you're not blown away by every false wind of doctrine. What are you putting into your mind? But more importantly, always keep in mind the knowledge that salvation has already been won. Jesus paid it for us on the cross. Be of good courage. He has overcome the world, he said. Going through a little drama in your life, going through a little troubled times in your life, keep on the helmet of salvation. And that simply means remember that God is on our side. And if God be for us, who can be against us, says Paul? No weapon. He didn't say some. He said no weapon formed against us will prosper. They will be formed, believe you me, but they will ultimately not prosper because God is on the throne. That's our defense as Christians. That's the message of salvation. It protects us through everything, even death. Because I live, you can live also. And so Jesus declared that he is resurrection and he is life. And based on that, Paul was able to tell us, their friends, I am convinced that nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God who is in Christ Jesus. Neither height nor depth, nothing, not even death, can separate us. And so we have all these pieces, right? The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the gospel shoes. He says, arm yourself then with a sword. Because you need to defend yourself. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Telling the children earlier, read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. He will put the words in our mouth when we walk in His Spirit, when we walk with the Lord in the light of His way, when we trust and obey. See, the Bible is our sword, and we will be able to stand up against the challenges. Remember Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. What was His greatest defense? Scripture. 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 It was able to help Him ward off the temptations. We can do the same, but we must train ourselves with the Bible now if we are to be prepared for battle. I'm challenging you this week. Anytime you feel tempted to do something, tempted to hit your spouse across the head, tempted to say something negative, tempted to really let that anger get the better part of you, just quote Scripture. The Lord is my strength. Right? I will look to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. I can tell you there are many times I'm sitting across from a client and I haven't a clue where to go next. But a simple prayer within. Lord, give me a word that I may speak life and purpose into your child. Person doesn't even know. And out of the blue, some wisdom appears. And is able to help those individuals. Walk in Scripture. Read it. Happy are those, he tells us in the Psalm, who walk in the Lord. And so Paul tells us, pray at all times above all else. Huh? See, prayer is our access to God. I like that hymn that says, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. We can go to God in prayer. And that's why we sing, in seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer. Yes, prayer gives us life. It keeps us in contact with God. So when you are on the fringes of battle, just remember God is always a prayer away. Lord, help me. I need you to survive. So read your Bible. Pray every day. Because in this passage from Ephesians, Paul tells us, dear friends, that we need to constantly be ready to battle against spiritual powers. Evil exists all around. And it doesn't go away just because we close our eyes or we don't think it's real. The good news is we have all we need. And I know it's a scary thing sometimes to stand up against the evil in our lives. Yes, it is. But we have the gospel and the promise of God in Jesus Christ. And we have the whole armor of God. All that's left for us to do is to put it on. And to join our siblings the world across and take our stand. So people of God, take your stand. Put on the whole armor of God. Fasten the belt of truth around your waist. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all these, take with you the shield of faith so that you will be able to quench the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And put these armor on daily. We have been given all the armor we need. And there is only one question left for us to answer as we face the battle. Are you ready? Amen.